What is your embassy? How many of you are
Welcome to Voyage to the Geek for another week. Joining me as always, Dan Miller, Tom McGill, Rick Legato. And no, Rick hasn't done anything with his hair. He's lost a little bit of weight.
It's in his spirit form.
Yeah. Rick is not joining us today in body, but in spirit. I'm sure he is with us as he is currently making... respiratory masks, breathing masks out of old socks, his old sock collection, and distributing that to the poor.
I'm sure that would kill all the viruses.
I hadn't thought of that, but you're right. There's science. Yeah. Dan has brought the science. And so this is part two of our deep dive, not that deep, into the 1992 sci-fi film.
It doesn't go that deep.
No, it's going to be the shortest tip you've ever seen.
Tom is only going to show you just the tip of the tip. yes, the 1992 sci-fi film Freejack, starring Mick Jagger.
Mick Jagger.
And his wife, Jerry Hall. She makes
a bit of an appearance. That's a bit of trivia.
Bit of an appearance in the film. Emilio Estevez, not Estevan. That is a singer from the 80s, I think.
Somebody completely different.
But not Emilio.
Gloria Estevan. That's it. And so today we'll have two little short segments. One's Tom's going to kick us off shortly with his segment, Just the Tip, and he's going to discuss all things trivia. And then later on in the show, I've got a bit of a quiz for the lads. A little bit of a special quiz this time. So let's not waste any more time. Tom, it's over to you with Just the Tip.
So, yeah, I was trying to find interesting things about the film other than the whole interest of what we see on the screen, how interesting the acting is and everything. So not much in there. I mean, going through mainly what I do in those cases when there's not much to say about, or not much to find, is I try to find some things about the actors that are interesting. One thing I did find interesting is that Vincent Schiavelli was in it, but was cut. So he is a guy who you absolutely recognize from the 80s. He's in every TV show, in every film. He's always some psychiatrist in some movie, or he's a assassin in Tomorrow Never Dies. He is a face that you will recognize, Vincent Schiavelli. Mm-hmm. He's a guy that you'll see him, you go, I know the guy, and I have no clue where I've seen him, but I've known him since I was a little child. He died a few years ago. He was on set, so there was a role for him, but then he's not in the credits and he's not in the film, so whatever happened there, nobody really, like, there was nothing else to find other than that he was there for the filming and now he's not in it.
Oh, you're very famous.
Yeah.
Very famous. This guy here.
Oh, yeah.
I told you. Definitely recognize him.
Okay, that's a little bit weird because, I don't know, there was plenty of those other type of people in the movie already. You know, the couple of the level bosses. What's the guy with the turtleneck and the machine gun and the katana.
The Grand El Bush.
Yeah, yeah. So there were a few of those type of people,
Mr.
isn't
Grand
there?
Bush. Yeah. As Dave said, there was Jerry Hall. So she was doing a cameo as a reporter in the disco. Nightclub. Yeah. Incidentally, that nightclub, there was lots of shots cut from the film because it did really badly at the test screenings.
Yes, I'd heard that.
Because it was even more brutal. There was more gore. There's not much blood and gore in this film, actually. There's fighting, there's shooting, but there's no gore. And so one of the shots that was cut, which was in that nightclub, was there as we get the opening shot of that nightclub, we see people in cages standing there. And what was happening there is that there were people auctioning off their lives, essentially.
Like as a free, like as a host, like a...
Yeah, for they would get decapitated.
Okay.
In by the auctioneer. So somebody was auctioned, you know, I'll cut this guy's head off for this much money. So they were, I don't know, maybe providing for the family or something, but that was a part of that film that happened in that nightclub. That
yeah, I can't remember.
No, it's not in the film. That's oh, totally okay. Cut out. That was removed.
Like with some,
that's an example of the gore that was removed.
Okay, cool.
To make the film more funny, give it a bit extra humor. So maybe that nut kicking scene was added later then. Maybe because they tried to get it more
you bring
funny.
Up the nut kicking scene. That was that was in between shows where we had that conversation. Remind us of what that what.
So Amanda Plummer, the nun, the totally over the top nun, kicks Michelette, who is one of the evil in between bosses. Jonathan Banks, who played in one of the films that we reviewed, another bad movie one of us really enjoyed, Buckaroo Banzai.
He played
a lizard.
He was the bad guy in Beverly Hills Cop as well. Not the main henchman.
Oh, was he?
But he's the guy that killed Eddie Murphy's mate, which sent the whole... The inciting incident was him killing his mate that came out to see him.
He's a classic character actor who turns up as the...
He's got very droopy eyes. He always looks like he's about to drop off to sleep.
He nicely plays bad guys. And I like that scene with... And there's things about this film that I liked. And one of the things that I really liked Mick Jagger in it because he was charming. And just the fact with the Fabergé egg, throws it to the guy and then makes himself destroy the egg on catching. Mick Jagger didn't hurt it. Anyway, yeah. I liked things. So, nutsack kicking. The nun gets beaten up by the bad guy. She's tied down because she helped Emilio Estevez escape. And she knows, I think, where he is or something. They want to get information out of her, so they hit the nun in the face. And she has already been established as a machine gun carrying nun. And she says, "The good Lord."
She's got this slight Irish accent, which is a bit weird as well.
Lord says to turn the other cheek.
Yeah.
But instead, she kicks him squarely in the nuts, and his eyes roll back into his brain, and he collapses.
I think one of the most memorable moments in Quentin Tarantino's Pulp Fiction is hers, belongs to her, when she stands up and delivers that line to the cafe, to all the people sitting in the booze in the cafe, to ante up you motherfuckers, every last one of you, you know, and just that crazy, it's in her eyes. She is a crazy looking actress on screen. Is she, I don't know, what is she like? Does she look like that in
everything? No, she can. She can totally. That's just Christopher Plummer's daughter.
Oh, you're kidding?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
That's why she is the way she is. It's her genes.
I didn't know that at all. That's awesome.
Plummer? Did that not
No, I didn't know her last name until you said it before.
All right. the other thing is another cameo that we're getting in the film, which is not mentioned on the IMDb trivia, is George Coleman, who is a famous jazz player.
Ah.
And so he's one of the big jazz masters. What's that? There's an equivalent for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. There's a National Endowment of the Arts, NEA Awards or something.
Right.
And that's where the big, you know, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, where all the big, big stars go. Well, the big stars of the jazz area go into the NEA.
And he was in the film.
He was there as cameo. He's just sitting in the window playing a saxophone.
Yeah,
that's
right. Or just camera goes, holds on him for a few seconds, then he's out of the film again.
Yep.
He's gone.
It's weird, right? This movie has just got all of these good possible ingredients, right? It's got good ingredient after good ingredient. Okay.
But
when you mix it all together...
But then you have henchmen cars
I could give you sugar, flour, eggs, all the rest of it. You're not going to make a fucking cake, mate.
That's true. That's true. Whilst it does have good ingredients, it also has less good ingredients.
David Johansson, we talked about him. He had an alternate persona as a singer.
I didn't know that.
Shit, you didn't. So now I... what's it? The feeling hot. What is it? What is his name?
Well, the song's called Hot, Hot, Hot. I used to play that in Yay Oldie Day.
He has a persona.
Oh,
Buster Poindexter.
That's it, Buster Poindexter.
Buster Poindexter with his band making music. That's and right. He used to impersonate Mick Jagger. Or he used to be always seen as somebody like a poor man's, a good Mick Jagger type sort of singer.
Mm-hmm.
Before he ended up in, I keep saying Jumping Jack Flash, but this is Jack...
Freeman.
Whoopi Goldberg was in Jack Flash.
Give me a movie with Jack in the title and I'll get them mixed up. It's too much Jack Daniels here.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, before they played with Mick Jagger in Freejack, he was already taunted as the American answer to Mick Jagger.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, Buster Poindexter had that song, Peeling Hot, 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 was ruined for the rest of his life, just like anyone who gets famous with a one-off thing.
One-hit wonder. Yep.
Yeah. For the rest of the life, you always have to sing that one song. And and I liked Frankie Faison, so he's the eagle guy that you both forgot to, even though he was the most over-the-top acting, even worse than Amanda Plummer, I think. And he's the, and I then remembered that he is the, in Coming to America, Eddie Murphy film, he's the landlord who they swap the rooms with. So they're in the... Arsenio Hall buys all that funky stuff for their room. Eddie Murphy wants to be looking, appearing as a poor guy for his girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
And he comes into his room and there's the hot bubble bath and the curtains and the jukebox is playing because Arsenio Hall spent all that money. And they need to quickly move, so they swap with the landlord. Landlord goes, oh, you can have my room. That looks poor and I'll move in here. That's the eagle-eyed dude here who's sitting under the bridge eating food. Guy.
You know who he is. I'll tell you who he is and you'll fall over. He's the guy in the original Crocodile Dundee movie that rips that boomerang-shaped thing off the back
is
of the limousine.
Really?
And throws it at the guy down the alleyway.
Wasn't that his
That's
driver?
Frankie
it's
Faison?
His driver. Same guy, same actor.
Interesting.
He was in Crocodile Dundee 2 as well.
Okay.
Where it all got too silly.
I hope that's not too spurious that you just said that there. I hope you can
I'm pretty
back
sure
that
it's
up.
Him. I remember looking at his pitch. I remember looking at him. This guy.
Yes, that's him.
He's the guy... put a set of sunnies on him and one of those leather caps like the cap that you turned up in.
Mm-hmm.
Put a leather one of those on and it's him.
Right.
It's definitely him.
And he has played in every Hannibal Lecter film.
Really?
Yeah, with Anthony Hopkins.
That's pretty cool.
So one thing I hadn't known was that Silence, because I never read the books, so Silence of the Lambs is part 2. There's
Red
a,
Dragon.
Yeah.
Yes, there's Red Dragon before that, which I didn't know about.
It's a film.
Red Dragon is a film, but that before Silence of the Lambs was made, it was a big hit. There was already a film made, about the Red Dragon book.
Oh, really?
It just was called Manhunter.
Oh.
1989, 88, something like that. Manhunter, and Hannibal Lecter was played by Brian Cox. Was also always a great bad guy. So, Frankie Faison played in that one, and in Silence of the Lambs, and in Hannibal, and in whatever, and then the Red Dragon.
Red Dragon.
So the only Hannibal film he didn't play in was when Rise of Hannibal, which was the one where Hannibal is a young boy.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the only, he plays different characters in all these films, but he's the same actor as always there.
It's interesting, bit of a coup to tie yourself to that franchise, though. I think pretty successful. Did you dive into the test audience, the audience testing?
Not too much diving, other than that I saw that it was doing really, really badly, and then they started rewriting new scenes and adding humor and taking out gore and trying to make it better.
The statement, as it reads here from IMDb, is according to the reports at the time of the production and interviews with some members of the cast and crew, test screening was so disastrous. So producer Ronald Chuzette, I think his name is, was brought in to reshoot almost half of the movie and add more character scenes and humour. Emilio Estevez said that director Jeff Murphy let them down by focusing too much on action.
This is the first version.
The movie was made and screened to a test audience. Yes, so it was a complete version.
And so Amelia was saying that the first version,
the original director
let them down,
was not interested in doing any dialogue scenes and stuff like that. He just wanted to do all action scenes, which is the stuff you were talking about earlier.
But then the action was pretty, like one of the horrible, horrible shots in that film from us, I guess, from as a visual effects artist, is the chase down the bridge when Emilio drives this car, which is has a champagne bottle at the front, which mm-hmm. gets successively shorn off the roof mm. and then the sides, and he ends up in this tiny little vehicle down the bridge, and then they have a blockade.
Yep.
And just last minute, and he's got Mick Jagger in the tank behind him, and he's got a weird flip-up laptop.
Emilio has a flip-up
laptop, which Mick Jagger remotely gets to open every time he wants to say a sentence. The laptop opens up. Can't get away now, can you? And he closes it, and then the thing goes up again. You can't get away from me that easily. Anyway, so he races down towards the blockade and then jumps off the bridge. And the horrible blue screen shot. That one thing, which I think is even in the trailer, which is... I don't know where they put their $30 million, but they certainly did not put it in the.
Well, I think it must have all gone to the cast.
Remember that when they get
Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Look, there's some big, even Estevas. Esteban. Esteban was still commanding a fairly good rate at that. There was some fairly big movies that he was in around that time. That's not that far off. Wild Boy.
Young Guns.
It's not that far off his timing. It's got to be around that time. So I reckon most of the money would have had to go to the acting.
Maybe.
The green screen, blue screen, green screen in it was pretty shocking.
It was terrible.
They got the Matrix thing that it turns into at the end, and they're all in these weird landscapes. And the green screen and the color grading of them to get them to match in the background.
And this is the guy who looks like John LaRoquette. Mm-hmm. Who had a part in the film of some form or another, and then he's gone. So yeah. I can only imagine that he was cut.
He's on the cutting room floor. Yeah,
of that first version of the film. And same with the nun. The nun. What happened to her?
Yeah, they were probably some gory death.
They probably all got sliced to bits or something, and that was cut out for additional humor.
So it's like the Schneider cut. I want to see the Freejack. What's the director's name? The original director.
He's slowing down the show.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, googling frantically.
What do you think? Right. We committed that to memory? Directed by Jeff Murphy.
See the Murphy cut.
Yeah, later we know. But I think I don't want to see it. Because what I enjoyed about this movie was the camp and the overacting.
I didn't get any camp. I thought they were actually acting. I thought they were trying to do exactly what they were paid to do.
All the main characters were trying, and all these secondary characters were just having
a ball. We're looking at it as an opportunity to go nuts.
Yeah. The expensive skilled actors were acting.
Yes.
To the best of their abilities.
Yeah.
Acting.
All right, I've got one trivia thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I've got another thing, just briefly. It's very obvious. It's not really trivia, but... Why did the Rolling Stones not make any music for that film?
Yeah, yeah.
If Mick Jagger is there, why wouldn't they have contributed to the soundtrack?
Something. You don't know?
No, I don't know.
Oh, you're putting it.
That's why I say it's not trivia. It's just a fact.
I thought you were about to lay some.
There is a fact there. They didn't, and maybe Mick Jagger already had that.
So
had enough.
The
by
band,
that time.
You know, Mick comes back to the band, and the band are like,
"Where were you,
Mick? Movie go? How was it? What did you do?"
And everybody, like, shut the fuck up for 2 hours and leave me alone.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Dan, what's your?
Oh, okay. You know the Wilhelm scream?
Yep. Oh yeah, that's in there as well. Yes. Yeah.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. This is this is the singer. I'm feeling good.
Yeah, yeah.
James Brown.
It's James Brown. Scream. No less. Ow!
Yep.
No less than 3 times.
Yes.
I counted. Not a Wilhelm scream.
No.
You're kidding.
It's a James Brown. Ow!
So do you think they sampled straight out of I Feel Good or something?
Yes, it's just that snippet.
It sounded very, very good.
Somebody falls over. Ow! You know, somebody crashes a car. Ow! What were they thinking?
So why wasn't James Brown in the soundtrack for the film? Probably because there was no soundtrack.
So so this film's pretty light on for trivia.
That was it about.
Talk to me about, really quickly, the post-production. Anything worth noting about this film in post-production, either on a negative or positive?
I did like the quality of the opening titles.
I didn't mind the opening titles either.
I saw them and I thought, that's starting nicely.
Yeah.
Nicely done.
Yeah.
So they were not bad.
Yeah, I like that. Where you've got a negative of the title, so it's a sort of
like jigsaw puzzle
it's
pieces?
Punched out, yeah. So it's, if you can imagine a negative and then all of the insides of the R's and things like that are all floating on their own.
Moving together,
comes together
to
say free cell. And yeah, I didn't mind that at all. I thought the laser effects for the time machine and
the
stuff.
The laser spider web when it
way
was...
it cut into real geometry in the scene and stuff like that. I didn't... From memory, I can't remember whether there was secondary lighting from it, actually lighting the scene, but I know that somebody must have gone in there and actually cut off a lot of these things to make it feel like it. And it did actually feel like it was in the shot, even though maybe they didn't have secondary lighting. For some reason, it seemed to comp in nicely, whoever did that. But very little else.
They had 3D models in there. Like they had a car with a little character person made out of, you know, the worst 80s cylinders that 3D graphics could produce at the time, I guess.
Was there many matte painting opportunities in this film, Tom? Can you
there
remember?
Was, well, there was the city stuff with that same structure that they hold onto with their hand to transfer their brain essence is actually the building that they are in. So on the on top of that skyscraper is this sort of four-pronged structure. And we see that in several matte shots.
It looks uncannily like the Emperor's...
the throne room on the Death Star.
The throne room in the Return of the Jedi. With the four big long things on at the top of a big tall spire, big tall tower.
There was a couple of internal shots that were obviously shot on a blue screen or green screen. They're going up at a couple of elevators inside the big mega building. They had the same sort of...
And it's always nice to see how badly people anticipate the future. I mean, this takes place in 2009. That's when it's supposed to play. And it was filmed in 1991. So they were thinking, we're establishing big laser guns and time travel within what? So we're talking 20 years. In 20 years, we'll have time travel and...
That's right.
They didn't have flying cars, but it wasn't really that far in the future. I mean, you have to explain why René Russo is still... hardly changed at all. Not even with grey hair on her head. I mean, was she
She pretty much looks
at the start?
Identical. They made no effort to age her at all.
Was she supposed to be 16 years old at the start of the film when he's in bed with her? She didn't age.
May well be. The dirty little secret behind Freejack.
You have a picture in there in your slideshow, which is the quote, the information is more important than knowledge, or the other way around. And then attributed to Kia Ora.
Ah, yes.
And the director is New Zealander.
That's a Kiwi term.
Yeah, it's just a greeting. So Geoff Murphy is a New Zealander.
I think they say Kai Ora.
I don't know how they pronounce it.
I think it's Kai Ora.
But it's not a person. So I guess he just smiledly put that in there. At the same time, it's written in ballpoint pen. It's a different pen than the writing of the quote. So I think he made it look like somebody else came past and said, wrote Kia Ora there. And it just looks like it's a quote with a person. But Geoff Murphy did one of my favorite films, which is The Quiet Earth.
All right.
So he'd done a movie. Now, I loved that film as a teenager and I haven't seen it since. So I probably have to rewatch it one day and see whether I can still justify liking it so much. But I have very pleasant memories from that film.
Another trivia one that I thought was weird in the movie is Emilio Estevez quotes and impersonates Arnold Schwarzenegger halfway through the movie.
He does. He
says, fuck you, asshole.
In this movie?
Yes. In this movie. And those movies were happening at the time when Arnold Schwarzenegger was pretty big. Now, what's up with that? Who thought that was a good idea?
Probably Emilio Estevez. Actors often have good ideas, Dan.
I do a great impersonation of Arnold Schwarzenegger. You should see it. It's a killer.
I think I should do all this expedition in this scene through liturgical dance. So we're a bit light on for trivia for this one.
Oh, we filled 10 minutes or something?
Yeah, there's certainly enough to get our teeth into. But that's it for another episode of Just the Tip. So that's Tom McGill's Just the Tip, looking at some trivia associated with the 1992 Freejack science fiction film.
You're so gentle.
All right, so we've got a very special probe. And the probe is where we have a bit of a quiz, a bit of a question-answer session based on how well you were paying attention to the film. So without wasting any more time, let's jump into the probe.
Sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
It may shock you. It might even horrify you.
So I've given the guys some buzzers. Dan, if you'd like to test your buzzer. This is a doorbell. Tom.
Newt, newt. Like
Bozo the Clown. And if you can keep them near the microphone there so our home listeners can hear you. Eagerly buzz in. Now, how well did you watch this film? Are you feeling pretty confident about your knowledge retention for the film?
Well, I've already admitted to actively blanking out parts of this movie.
I know that I watched it twice on the same day, but that was when we had, you know, we were a few weeks behind our initial schedule, so I haven't seen this film in over a month, so I probably don't remember much either.
Well, that's good. Because we're not doing anything about this film. This is the first. This is round one of our, I'm going to say quarterly. So we're going to do this only quarterly, maybe four times a year in amongst all of our film ventures. And what this is general science fiction knowledge.
Great Scifi quiz.
Okay.
We're going to be jumping around Scifi all over the place. And what we're going to do is tally the scores, keep the scores, and by the end of the season, we will know who is our great sci-fi quiz master for 2020. Now, Rick is obviously absent tonight, so the way I thought we could include Rick is that if I ask a question and both of you get it wrong, Rick gets the points.
Irish. What? He's going to win.
That sounds, that sounds a little unfair.
I had that thought, but I also thought, I'd love to be able to tell him tomorrow that he won the quiz.
Because the other dimwits were too stupid to get the points.
That would be desperately bad, wouldn't it?
Now, Rick sent his answers in already for the quiz. He has sent in John Cleese, Banana, 35, Llama, Orange, English Muffin, Long Walks on the Beach, Waving My Magic Wand, Steven Spielberg, Blanche the Asparagus, and Hand Shot First. Now, none of those are the answers to any of the questions I've got, so...
they might be better than ours.
I'm going to keep them
there.
We'll
keep them in reserve.
They might work out, but I think next time he might need the questions. I think he thought he could send me answers and get them right without the questions. Little cocky, but
he's always ahead of the game, old Rick, isn't he?
That's right.
Always trying to be ahead of the game.
All right, so let's get started. We've got a bit of a presentation up here, and Rick is going to appear on the boards. Here's our first question: which character speaks in the first line in the original 1977 Star Wars movie?
Oh shit!
Who was that? Oh, that was Tommy. Tom.
C-3PO.
Tommy says C-3PO. Dan, do you have any alternative answers to that?
Well, I suppose I have to say R2-D2 then.
So the answer is C-3PO. And I believe he is... is he not the last person to... No, maybe they didn't bookend it. No, he had some connection.
Oh, at the end?
Yeah, I think in the final film, he might have been the last person to say something.
The end of that film is really odd because they blow up the Death Star. And I think the last thing that anybody says might be, Carrie! When Luke jumps at Leia and gives her and says...
Big hug.
Carrie instead of Leia. And I don't even know if there's anything being said after that because then they just stand there, they get their medals, they're smiling, there's polished androids.
Well, there's R2-D2 no getting lifted out of the X-Wing.
R2-D2 does a little giggle at the end, doesn't he?
At the very end.
But C-3PO is standing right there while R2's getting, and he's going, oh, I hope you can repair him sort of thing. Yeah. I got a feeling that might be the last thing said in that film.
No, if you're counting R2-D2, then it's probably at the ceremony because Chewbacca goes, and R2-D2 does a boop-de-boop. So it's one of those two guys there.
And we know what Chewie said in that moment. Where's my fucking medal?
Why didn't
I? You kidding?
You bastards.
All right, so the points go to Tommy. Next question. Captain Kirk is the most famous captain of the USS Enterprise. It's getting in a bit quick. But who...
Oh, do we want to wait till you're finished reading?
You might have to...
Well, I think
I think if you want to jump in early...
That's the risk. You know, you can risk it and jump in early.
Who had the job before him in the TV series?
We're not talking actors, but we're talking
captains. No, we're talking characters.
Christopher Pike.
And the answer is Christopher Pike, who apparently was so good in the most recent Star Trek Discovery series on Netflix.
Anson Mount.
He's just scored his own series. It's going to be called Where No Man Has Gone Before. Because
as Christopher Pike?
Yeah, he takes the first five-year mission. And then Kirk takes over from him when he gets fucked up in this...
That's later. Mm-hmm. He gets fucked up a bit later after, because in that episode in the cage,
the cage.
No, the cage is the pilot movie, but then they cut it into a two-parter in the first series, and that two-parter has a certain title.
That's right, because they went back to the... Yeah.
Was recent, so at the time, Kirk did not know about Pike's incident, so he took over without that incident.
So Tom gets the points, 20 points. When Doctor Who came back to TV in 2005, it filmed under a secret code name. What was the code name?
Shit. Hand shot first.
I was thinking exactly that.
Orange.
So you probably have to be a bit of a Doctor Who nerd for this one. Although it's a little bit trivial. What was the code name for Empire Strike, for Return of the Jedi? It was Blue Harvest, wasn't it? All the crew were walking around with jackets in the forest filming Star Wars Return of the Jedi, but they all had Blue Harvest memorabilia all over them to throw off the fans wouldn't let them shoot.
Okay.
They wouldn't leave them alone. So, no takers?
Nope.
All right. So, it Torchwood, which went on to become a series, a spin-off series.
Yeah, I remember that now that you said it.
Rick gets the points. Next question. Which of these four Marvel characters was not recast in a later film? The Red Skull, General Thunderbolt Ross, Bruce Banner, or Colonel James Rhodes? Tommy?
General Thunderbolt Ross.
Is that your... Dan, would you like to offer a backup?
Okay, I'll go with Red Skull.
I thought long and hard about this one, and I probably would have gone with Dan, but the answer... was indeed Thunderbolt Ross. In fact, he's in The Black Widow as well, coming up in 2020, as the same character. So he was the same guy when Eric Banner was the Hulk. Because it was his daughter that was the girlfriend of the Hulk.
Betty. Betty Banner.
Betty.
Jennifer Connelly.
Yes.
Back in that film.
Yes. Ang Lee film?
Ang Lee. Yeah. Great editing. Annoying editing, but great. Moving away from the norm of making the film with these weird comic book panels sort of stuff.
A lot of people forget that he's who he is in Infinity War, especially Civil War. Remember those panels where the bunch of the higher-ups, the executives are saying, no, he's an enemy, and hunt him down. Yeah, he's in it. He's the guy that they hang up on. They just hung up on him in the middle of a conference call. Yeah, because he's telling them to go and arrest Captain America, and they're saying, nah, fuck you. Okay, so Tommy gets the points. He's having a bit of breakaway. What is the superhero alter ego of the character Billy Batson? Billy Batson.
I gave you time.
Dan's not even buzzing in.
I'm not even... Shazam? I don't know.
Yes,
what
it is
Shazam.
Oh, it's the boss. And he hadn't even answered it, so you gave him the answer.
I knew the answer.
Hey,
give it to Dan because he like, well,
you can see Dan on Sail of the Century just answering questions. Everybody else is getting the money.
Even the colours would give it away here. The t-shirt colours give it away.
Yeah, the red and the yellow. So Tommy gets the points. It is, of course, Shazam. And according to my research, I may also accept Captain Marvel.
Because Captain Marvel was the old title of the Shazam comic book. And then they...
There was some split, wasn't there? Everybody got angry and...
Marvel bought the rights and they had used... Captain Marvel wasn't made anymore at the comic book. And then Captain Marvel name was bought by Marvel. Mm. Or they started using it. And so when DC... Was it DC? It was DC, isn't it? Shazam, yeah. So when they brought it back, they came up with a new name.
So Tommy gets the points. Hands on buzzers.
I gave him time. I did wait.
You gave me time and he gave you the answer.
It's fair.
It's payback for the time. All right, next question. Ooh. The next question is triple points.
It's yeah, a big comeback get coming back in here
potentially.
Game.
Either a runaway or a comeback. Here we go. Jeff Bridges plays a game developer programmer, Kevin Flynn, in which 1982 American science fiction film?
Do you want to give me, you want to say it?
I'm really slow today. I am just so slow. My brain is just ticking over, tick, tick.
I should have
and
put
the
a
answer
picture.
Is?
I should Wrong. Have put it, absolutely Tron. I should have put a picture of him in that at that age. It's hard to associate this old grizzly looking bloke with Tron. He was such a young, fresh-faced, what, 22-year-old or something?
He looked so weird in the new Tron remake when they digitally made him look young. Mm. That was freaky. That was uncanny. Mm.
Yeah, I agree, Tommy. So Tommy gets the points on that one again. Next question. In Game of Thrones, what is the name of Westeros' capital city?
I don't know.
I know it.
You'll know it when
I know
you hear it.
I know it.
You'll definitely know when you hear it.
It's
nobody's buzzed in. Well, points could be going to Rick. And Rick would have got this.
End. Something's end. Journey's end.
West
no,
end.
Not West. Trotwood.
So, damn, no takers. Oh. And Rick gets the points. It's King's Landing.
That's right.
That's close.
Journey's End, King's Landing, yes.
All right, next.
Has similar letters somewhere.
Next question. In which film do the aliens' heads explode when they hear Slim Whitman's Indian Love Call?
Mars Attacks.
Yes. Points each, because Dan knew it, he just was too afraid. See the digital walls around their heads.
And this is the actual song too.
Yeah.
When I'm calling you.
So the points go to...
Give it to Tom. No, he was faster.
I'm honest.
Is it?
I hit the buzzer, but I let Dan say the answer because we're both in
Look. That's not how the quiz works. You can't...
You can't share. It's a fight to the death. It's like the Thunderdome. It's like...
Two men enter, one man leaves.
Yeah, it's
a null win, so you both get points.
They share
and
the
Rick
win.
Gets points as well.
Oh, that's hard.
Well, it's a nullified question because you buzzed in and then didn't give me the answer.
It'll nut up
And then he
again.
Gave me the answer and didn't buzz in. Uh-huh. So both of you disqualified yourself.
I want fun. I don't want animosity of Dan hating me for the rest of his life because I spoiled it.
But Dan doesn't want you to make it easy.
Too late.
All right, ready to go?
Yep.
Okay, name one of science fiction author Isaac Asimov's three rules of robotics.
I'm going for the speed this time, not the correct answer. Don't hurt people.
It's fairly
That's
close.
The gist. That's
it's
the gist.
Fairly close.
Yeah.
Through action or inaction, don't cause harm to people or something.
That's pretty close. I think the additive of those that end through action or inaction is close enough.
Then
for
be
me.
Harmed or have. Yeah.
So the first law of robotics is a robot may not injure a human being or through inaction allow a human being to come to harm. Second law, a robot must obey the orders given to it by human beings except where such orders conflict with the first law. And the third law is a robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first two laws. That's a pretty awesome little set of like commandments for robots, isn't it?
Didn't he have a story where there was like a robot that was attempting to follow these rules but was having trouble interpreting them?
Well,
because
that is iRobot.
Hey?
That is iRobot, where the Uber bot who...
That's right.
Who controls everything, decides that in order to protect the humans, they must be enslaved.
Yes.
They must be protected from each other.
Well, this is the different
Without
one
harm,
that I was thinking about.
But enslaved.
The one that I was thinking is that because the robot was in a moral dilemma about how to act, all it could do was like circle, just, you know, sort of drive around in circles around this person who needed help because they couldn't help it or he couldn't hurt it or something or other. Mm. Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's either something I remembered or something I made up.
Either way, it's real, okay? It's real.
It's real either way.
Because real is subjective. All right. Next one. Well, in fact, this is a scores stop off. So at the moment, Dan's coming last.
Dan is getting beaten by somebody who isn't even here.
Rick. Rick is coming second, and Tom is way out in front on 80 points. Now, I can tell you that we do have at least two more triple point stop offs.
Okay.
All right.
So we're just at the halfway mark now.
So there can be a comeback here. So next question. In what year did the Daleks first appear in Doctor Who? This is closest to the year we'll
1962. 1964.
Closest without actually going over. Is that the idea? Is it Price is Right rules?
I didn't go Price is Right rules. I mean closest to.
Well,
62
and 64. If it's 63, it's a tie. We both get points.
It is a tie.
Is it 63?
It is 63. Oh. And you both get the points.
Crazy.
It was a dead rubber. Moot.
This is the episode where they put them on the carpets and then they couldn't move anymore because they had metal floors and they got all their movement energy through the floors.
I like that. Isn't that the number one way to get rid of a Dalek?
Stairs.
Yeah. Yeah, no longer though. They overcame that.
Next question. In the TV adaptation of The Witcher, what is the full name of Henry Cavill's lead character?
Shit.
I got a feeling if Rick was here, he would nail it. He probably knew the answer.
Yep. And I will accept just his first name, as opposed to his full name, which is of a place, like Tom of Belconnen. I will
Butcher of Bragdavnovich.
I will accept his first name.
But that's not Ewick.
The second anybody mentions his actual name, I will remember.
No takers.
No.
Rick's up for the points again. It is Geralt of Rivia.
Yes, see? Of told you I'd remember it.
Yeah. When you give us the answer, we remember it.
I'm yet to see that, but I think we should all sit down and watch at least an episode and maybe do a show on it.
But actually, it's not a qualified question because it's not a sci-fi film.
Aha. Uh-huh. Technicality.
So, yep, technicality. Mm. Move it.
I might be onto something here. I tried to include some fantasy.
Cause, science cause Rick... slash fiction.
There you go.
That's exactly what I did, Tom.
There's a capital in the second part. All right. Rick gets the points. Next question. We're 30.
All right. This is my time to shine.
Hands on buzzers, gentlemen.
Okay.
Get it up closer to the mic there.
Oh, okay.
Again, I need to be able to... It could come down to the nanosecond. Complete the following famous quote from the TV...
Oh, come on.
Danger, Will Robinson.
Oh, fuck. I was looking at the people, not the fucking question.
You said it's war, so war it'll be.
Looking at the picture.
Well, Tommy got the points. There was a... And this is the guy that said it. I think he's the voice of the robot, this guy.
Mr. Robbie.
Triple points. God damn it.
Yep. Triple points and 120. Where were Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings movies filmed?
Got to step it up today.
God, I'm so fucking slow.
You actually buzzed him before I said a word of the question.
But he still didn't buzz.
But
him,
I so do know the action.
But I'll say New Zealand before you take the points away again.
But I'll say New Zealand.
Ooh, New Zealand. So choice, bro.
Well, if we go on the pronunciation, Dan got it right.
don't patronise me. It won't help. It will not help.
But Tommy I like gets the that. Points.
It is a good picture, isn't it? It's pretty cool. All right, next question. In 2001, A Space Odyssey, what song does the rogue computer
system... I think I was definitely clearly in front
closer to
there.
Dave. You were definitely closer.
Yes.
The computer system HAL 9000 sings what song as he is shut down?
Daisy.
Bicycle Built for Two?
Bicycle Built for Two?
Daisy.
I think Dan's close enough. The song is called, it's a nursery rhyme called Daisy Bell.
Oh, is that what it's called?
But a lot of people know it as Bicycle Built for Two.
All for the love of you. Won't be a stylish marriage. I can't afford the carriage. But we'll be sweet upon the seat of a bicycle built for two.
It is quite a creepy. It's a creepy scene in that film, isn't it? Where he's chosen that to be shut down.
Yeah.
So who do the points go to?
Me, clearly.
yet.
That's right. You even.
There's a light speed handicap that I have, because that is about half the distance, so his sound travels. Yep. Arrives earlier, so even if
to
I press,
my microphone, that's right. I was wondering why you were keeping it away from your microphone. You're playing the what's it called, the right, Doppler effect.
Yeah.
I'm trying to interfere destructively with the sound waves.
All right, next question. The Class M3 Model B9 General Utility Non-Theorizing Environmental Robot features in which 1960s American science fiction television series?
Hand shot first.
No takers?
Non-theorizing environmental robot.
This might help, but it probably won't.
1960.
Nicknamed Gunter.
Good. Yeah.
Gunter.
Oh.
Probably by some nerd in
well,
the
hang on.
Department.
What? What? Okay, I have to okay, go by okay. the... I have to just say Moonbase Alpha because...
Oh, Dan's buzzed in.
Buck Rogers.
No.
I was just going by the process of elimination. All the shows that I don't know much about, that's the ones I have to mention now. So that's why I'm saying Moonbase Alpha. But you said... No, it's not Buck Rogers.
Nope. So it was Moonbase Alpha your...
That's all I can say right now.
All right. Neither. I threw this one as a bit of a trick. Yeah. A bit of a trick question in here. Not to the question, but the fact that two questions ago was a Lost in Space question. I thought if I do one similar, you're probably... It's a false... a red herring. I think you might have been gone in the wrong direction. Because that's... You probably didn't consider that.
Robbie?
So that is what his real name is. I thought his Gunter. Name was a... clunking tin can of rusty innards.
Bubbling boob.
Yeah, bubbling.
So yeah, that Gunter, that is the name associated with him as a prop. So Rick gets the points. Lost in Space was the answer for that one. Ooh. How old was Jedi Master Yoda? Tom's buzzed in. Jedi Master Yoda when he died in Star Wars Return of the Jedi.
900.
900
years old.
That's correct.
What about my guess?
What was your guess?
The same age as Mick Jagger.
Who was born in...
I might have to program in half points
11,
for next time.
11,
because that deserves some points. And he even looks a little bit like Mick Jagger.
It could be QI rules. You don't get points for the correct answer, but for the more interesting one.
Yeah, absolutely. So Tom gets the points. Next question. Triple points. In the film Jurassic Park, what is the name of the island where the park is located? This is tricky because some of the movies were on a sister island.
Yes. And I'm going to name the island now, and it could be the wrong one. Isla Nublar.
Isla
Nublar. But the way you look, it's not the right answer. Otherwise,
similar.
You wouldn't look.
Pronunciation is a little. Unless Dan can come with the exact pronunciation, you'll have the points. Isla is correct.
Isla Nublar, I think.
Island A, Island B.
I got a feeling at some point in the trilogy, they've referred to it as Site A and Site B.
That's all I can remember. Put it that way.
So it's Nublar.
Nublar.
And
I would say that was close enough.
And the first island is the last island. So the last film where the volcano's going off is the actual first island. There's the old park, but here is the big brand new Jurassic World.
Mm-hmm.
The second movie, which had Jeff Goldblum was in it, but
he's
Sam,
in all of them.
Sam Neill was not in it.
Yes.
Jeff Goldblum has a daughter in it.
Yeah. And they've got a Spinosaurus.
It's the bus hanging off the cliff.
Mm-hmm.
That's not on this island.
Mm-hmm.
That's on a different island.
Mm-hmm.
So, who got the points?
I said Isla Nublar.
Tommy got
you
the points.
Say,
That was close enough.
I said
enough.
Nublar. I forgot the L.
That was close enough for
I
me.
I would say so.
Yeah, no, that's no problems with that.
Pretty good guess.
It's shot in Hawaii on a specific ranch in Hawaii where they shoot a lot of these types of... what's the other one? What's the Rock and Kevin Hart? Jumanji. They shoot a lot of the Jumanji stuff there as well.
Not the right mountains for it. If that's not a map painting...
Well, it's a private ranch, so it keeps all the prying eyes out as well. Okay, Tommy gets the points. Next question. In the Alien movie series, what is the name of Ellen Ripley's pet cat?
Oh.
And it's not Orangey.
not even played by Orangey.
Probably the actual.
Oh, the cat is. And it's not Neutron. Neutron, is it?
No.
Nope.
I think it's a lot more mundane. It's like,
one of those things that, once again, once you tell us, we'll go.
Yeah, it's like Mr. Frisky or something or other.
What?
No tigers?
What the cat?
Okay, I'll give you my best guess.
Okay.
It's something like Mr. Frisky, but I think it's got just a regular human name in it.
So there's elements of that that are very close.
You can't get away with that. Just say, it's a name! Not. It has a name of sorts.
Aha! I'm happy with very close. Well,
no, Mr. Kibbles.
The element.
Yes, it's like Mr.
There are elements that are very close.
Okay.
But it'd be like you're asking for cornflakes, milk and sugar, but you've only got sugar. And then, but you've also given me tomatoes and something else. So it's not close enough to be the answer.
Damn it.
No, I can't drag it. No takers.
Can't surface
them. Oh, Tom, Rick gets the
Jonesy.
Point.
Jonesy.
Jonesy. Which you said like a human name.
Yeah.
Human, like a living creature.
Yes.
Which sort of.
Animals. Like a sound.
Which sort of covers.
It's like a sound.
It's human name sort of covers a lot of pets' names, doesn't it?
And you were right.
I was thinking Sam for some reason. Sam's like Jones, right?
Yeah, it's not.
I mean, they don't sound the same, but they're equivalent in my mind.
They've got one letter in common.
All right. This is the final question. So, and we won't see the points. No, we'll see the points next.
Less of the points we see, the better, in my opinion.
Okay. In the Disney sci-fi movie, The Black Hole.
Oh, God.
What was the name of the evil blade-spinning robot?
It's not Maximilian, is it?
All answers have to be said in the form of an answer, not with a question mark at the end.
I'm getting confused now because I think Maximilian Schell and Maximilian is confusing me, but I'm just going to say Maximilian.
Maximilian for Tom. Anything, Dan?
Some sort of sound made by humans.
No, it's a name. He has actual.
No, it's got a name.
He's got a proper name. But is it Maximilian?
So it is Maximilian.
It is. I was confused because the main actor, there's Maximilian Schell there. So they're giving the actor and the robot, they have the same name. So that confuses anyone.
Yep. And at the end of the film, the doctor ends up inside that robot
on some demonic planet. Good.
Gets a bit waffly at the end there. So Tommy gets the points. Maximilian. Final scores. Wow. Look at that. Decimated the landscape with that score. Tom has scored 180 points. The highest score we've ever had in the quiz. I did a few more questions and a few more triple points that we had in there as well. Dan, 40 points and
a massive 40 points.
Thank you. And Rick has done really well to pull a second. Now, what does this tell you, boys? About life. About life.
The dummy.
Sometimes it's best to just shut up. Just don't say anything. Just stand in the corner. Don't say anything.
I won't be here next time.
Oh, I'm not coming next time.
I want that at there to be my placeholder. You can do the show.
Very good, gentlemen. I thoroughly enjoyed that. So that brings us to the end of The Probe.
What the hell is going on around here?
Back off, man. I'm a scientist.
There is no truth.
Don't cross the streams.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
It may shock you. It might even horrify you.
So that's The Probe for another episode. And it brings us to the end of our second episode for our medium deep dive.
Shallow.
There just wasn't enough
shallow splish
in the pool to go too deep, was there? No. And the 1992 sci-fi movie Freejack. Not
Jumping Jack
not
Flash.
Not Jumping Jack Flash. So before we leave, it's always good to get our rating system up and running for the movie that we're reviewing. And we have a buy, borrow, burn rating system, although Dan finds a way every week to try to reinvent the rating system. So we're going to start with Tom. Tom, where are you with this film?
I'm in a borrow.
A borrow?
Oh, yeah. I wouldn't buy it, but I enjoyed it and I'd watch it again.
Dan?
I'll stick with the rating system, and it's definitely burn.
It suits your purposes this time.
Burn. And not only that, I think it is, in my opinion, the equal worst. It was that and Transformers, whichever Transformers one we watched.
Yeah. Equal worst. And Transformers set a really low bar.
Maybe that's the true reason that Rick isn't here today, because he just didn't want to watch the film. Maybe he knew already.
Guilt. Maybe it's a statement.
I think it's a statement. Because he brought it upon us.
Yeah, he was the one who suggested it.
That's
the problem.
That's my problem with it.
He was afraid of the wrath he would incur today.
Yeah, it's horrible trick he played on us. It's like,
I'm with Dan. I'm with Dan. It's that scene from Tarantino's new Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, where the main actor goes to town with his flamethrower on some poor chick in his pool that's trying to stab everyone in the house. There's not enough fuel in that flamethrower for me to burn this. I started purging it from my memory subconsciously, apparently, because I know I sat to the end of the damn thing and I still can't remember half the things that were flashing up on the screen here or that you guys were talking about.
What I want to know is they had a test screening, right? And the people hated it.
I want to see that film.
Well, did they dare have another test screening after this? Or did they just put it into the cinemas without one?
Wouldn't it be good?
Because is this worse or better?
Imagine if the film that they...
They test screened
yeah. was just out of its timeline.
Yeah. And maybe that's the better
thing.
And
film. Now it would be this perfect confrontational sort of thing with nuanced. And in 92, they just didn't understand it because it's not only a test, it's an American test audience probably as well. They might not have got it because the New Zealand director, right? There was a lot of UK cast in it as well. Maybe there's more European influence in the writing and the narrative, which we've spoken about in the past. You sort of have to dumb down for the American audience, given the demographic of the film-going audience over there, especially these test audiences. I'd love to see that original film.
I'd love to see the original...
Would you, though?
Original cut.
Just to answer that question, I would probably find more interest in watching that thing than this thing. And I can never unsee it. So for me, I rate it as one of
you
the
have worst. Unseen quite a lot of it already.
It is, it is one of the worst films we've ever done.
Yes. No. I think it's terrible.
No, it's been worse.
No. It's terrible.
Show us the list of films we've done. I'll point
as
out
I said before,
five that are worse.
I have the right opinion.
Yeah, that's right. So we're allowed to think whatever we want, but Dan's going to remind us of what's right.
Yes. I have the right.
It's correct.
At least we have the right to say what we want.
All right, that brings it to a close for Freejack, thank God. And next time we come back, hopefully Rick will be on board, and we're also going to be having a look at a brand new film. Feel free to contact us through all the socials, Facebook, Twitter, and everything else. And also send us anything through those channels if you want us to cover something specifically.
Yeah, if you've got a good idea for a film.
Yeah, we've got a couple of ideas. We've had a few people sort of drop some ideas in there. One was to do the whole trilogy, the whole episode 7, 8, 9 of the latest Star Wars films, and do it in one show. And so that whole story arc sort of thing. And we might have a look at that in the future. But yes, if you've got any ideas like that, please send them to us and we will consider those. So that's it for another show, gentlemen, of Voyage of the Geek. Until next time, it's bye from me.
See you.
Auf Wiedersehen.
How many of you?